So the basic idea of this is to chat. It's very conversational. It's not uncut.
I've done it.
Seems like you grew up and had the entire world of opportunity at your feet, and yet you chose filmmaking.
I grew up as an art student. Went to art schools from the time I could walk. Studied photography classically, was trained by a portrait photographer, studied monorail photography, Scheinflug techniques. Began writing very precociously. A lot of bullshit, you know. I seek in my life frailty, that kind of stuff, which at the High School of Music and Arts can get you laid. And my family has been in the entertainment industry for three generations, so I never thought I was going to be a civilian. Mm.
Was your grandfather a huge influence, or did you even get to know him really? Or
knew him very well, oh my God, yeah.
He was part of your life?
Oh, big part. Matter of fact, before my first film, with his thick Russian accent, he took my hand in both of his and he said, "Piotr, never forget, if people don't want to come to the theater, you can't stop them." And my father worked on Broadway, and my stepfather was a conductor, and that's all I knew. I didn't know anything else except the entertainment industry. And I came from a very political family. I come from a blacklisted family. So politics were really important to me. So I first wanted to make documentary film because I thought that was the greatest amalgam of writing and photography and relevance and the world around me.
Was this before you were a drummer, or was that?
No, it was after. After I was a drummer. I was a young guy, I was a drummer.
So you wanted, did you want to be a musician, or was that kind of just a kid thing?
I didn't know if I wanted, oh no, I played with some good people. I didn't know if I wanted to draw, if I wanted to be a painter, or if I wanted to be a musician. I only applied to music schools and art schools. I only applied to conservatories. And at the very last second, my mother said, "No, you have to go to a liberal arts college." Huh. So I did. And I'm glad I did. And it just, things evolved. It just seemed to me that the best amalgam of all the things that I cared about would be documentary film.
And again, were you a TV anchor before you became a filmmaker? Were you already thinking
about
it?
Well, I wanted to make documentaries, and I was hired by CBS, and I worked at CBS Reports for a while as a gopher, and then when I graduated high school young. I was 16, so I was pretty young, and after a year or so, for some bizarre reason, I guess, because when I was 21, I was fairly symmetrical looking, and I was hired by the CBS in New York to anchor the news, and then just seemed absolutely bizarre to me, and I did that.
A small thing.
It just didn't interest me that much, to be really honest with you. I was much more interested in, I mean, I got to cover some good stuff, and I got to cover Vietnam, and I got to cover, I was doing the news in Chicago during the convention, the 68 convention and the riots and all that stuff. So those things were really interesting to me, except, as I said to somebody, the thrill of being recognized in inferior restaurants wears off fairly quickly, and it just wasn't, and I wasn't good at it. And I began to realize that I wanted to write a sentence that would have an impact on somebody rather than the sentence that was accurate. I wanted to take a photograph that was artful rather than the photograph that was a recording. I don't believe a camera is a recording device. I think a camera is a sketch pad that's blank and a number two soft pencil. And I became more interested in the art of it. I describe my career as a journalist as almost 7 years totally unencumbered by fact.
Hasn't changed much.
Yeah.
Sadly.
Well, it was mine. So this is what I fell in love with, and this is what I'm as passionate about as anything in the world, with the exception of my family. And I want to do it until I get good at it.
So when you got behind the camera the first time and you made your first film, did you just know? Was it, were you in the right place then after?
Well, I've always felt dwarfed by it. I've always felt, I see so many people who are better at it than I am. And I want to get there. There was one of the mantras of my childhood was a wonderful raconteur I heard on the radio. And he said he didn't know where he was, except he knew where he was going. And he knew where he was wasn't it. So for me, it's trying to get someplace, trying to get better.
So what is it that you see as the Holy Grail? I mean, is it the...
There's a group of filmmakers whose work I revere, and I want to be as good as they are. The problem is, as you do this a lot, and as you get older and know more, you can see better. And as a result of seeing better, I see the gulf between me and the people I think are dazzling. And I think the gulf's getting wider. I don't think the gulf's getting narrower, because I see better.
Well, you've chosen a great deal of time to do all the many of the key jobs yourself. I mean, you've been the DP, you've been a writer, you've been
that's
the
all I do. That's what I do. That's what I am. It's not a conscious choice. It's I grew up as a photographer. I grew up as a writer. I've been paying my rent since I'm 20 years old as a writer. I don't know how to bifurcate filmmaking into this job, that job, that job. Most people who direct films, I will guess, will tell you that they have a film in their head. And the talent, skill, technique, whatever it is, the charter is to get as close to that movie that's in your head as you possibly can. Because I grew up as a photographer, it's just, I can put on screen what I see. That doesn't mean other people couldn't put better images on the screen. It just means I can put my image on the screen. I liken it to, somebody says, how do you wear all those hats? And I said, well, first place, I don't have hair, so it's a bit of a necessity. I said, secondly, it's, if you were fluent in Japanese and you were working in Tokyo, would it be easier for you to just talk to somebody, or would you want to use an interpreter? Photography is the language I speak, that's all.
So have you been fighting that the whole time? I mean, the industry obviously doesn't work that way as a rule.
Well, it was acrimonious in the beginning, and the Photographers Guild, the union, did not want me and wouldn't let me in, and it became contentious, and then after a number of years, about 30 years ago, they let me in. On the other hand, they don't like me very much, and I became very friendly with Conrad Hall, and Connie and I used to talk, and about 15 years ago, Connie called me up and she said, how come you're not in the ASC? It's ridiculous. You've made some of the most complicated visual film. I said, well, they don't like me very much. She said, nonsense. I'll sign your application and Haskell Wexler will sign your application. Will you join? I said, I'd be honored, sure. So they did, and I was called down for this interview. I think it was on Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood. And about 48 hours later, a registered letter came to my house and said, you've been rejected, which I have framed in my office.
They actually registered the letter to make sure that
make sure I got it.
Were fully rejected.
Yeah. So.
Well, they haven't had much love for Steven Soderbergh either. I mean, Peter Andrews, his nom de plume.
Yeah, Steven has referred to he and I as the committee of two. So
did you, I mean, as you got hotter as a filmmaker, as you know, Capricorn One was a hit, as you got into Outland, which was a great movie, and all those that run of that great period of films that everybody kind of loves, and historic, really, did you feel that you were getting hot? Did you feel like you were in a groove, or did you were just doing the work?
Well, I've been very spoiled and privileged for a long period of time where I was asked to do films, and I didn't kind of know what it was like to be a coyote in the winter, you know, running around hungry and skinny and foraging for food. So I've been spoiled, and I think one of the reasons is that I write, you know. Mm-hmm. I felt that I was in demand. I never felt that I was one of those people at the, you know.
Even when you were doing all studio movies, it wasn't,
no.
Did it feel like that?
No.
Huh. Did it feel like you were getting the work, you were progressing in your work?
I think I'm getting better, except to me getting better is like a little person getting taller. You know, it's, you can still be short. As I said, I see the gulf, and the gulf doesn't narrow. Mm. And then I see movies like Her, and I see, you know, movies like Silver Linings Playbook, and they're people I just think are wonderful, just absolutely wonderful, and I don't count me among them.
Of course, you really do a very different thing than those guys do. I mean, it's kind of, I think, do you feel like your films represent you and what you, how you see the world, how you...
I don't know if, it's a very interesting question. I don't know. I really don't know. I just get a crush on an idea or a particular story, and that's what I'd love to do.
Because you're known kind of, I guess, for action and humor.
Yeah, I like those things in a movie. I like exciting movies.
And when something like Running Scared comes along, does it feel like a twist on what you did?
Well,
I tried to
make a film. I mean, you know, buddy cop films were not the rarest animal in the world, and I went, okay, let me try to do something. Let me try to flange it. So I wanted it to be very funny, and I wanted to mix it being funny with some kind of big and tough action, and I wanted to cast it in a differently than what you used to. So I'd seen Billy Crystal's work on Saturday Night Live and on Soap, and I just thought he was a genius, and it turns out he is. And besides being one of the dearest people in the world, and I had seen Gregory Hines' work going back to a film called Wolfen, and I just thought the two of them would be so interesting together, and different than what people had seen. And I think that turned out to be a good guess.
So that's just, you're just, you had a script, you kind of went in the direction that was interesting?
No, the original script was about two elderly cops in New York who retire, and I said, no, I'd like to make it about two young cops in Chicago who don't retire, and we went from there.
And then, but then from then it was just, you know, you're doing your work, you're not building a career, you're not going, trying to make a big hit, you're not trying to do...
Oh, I think anybody who tries to make a hit is going down a very dangerous path. I think you have to make what you like. You have to go, I like this, not they're gonna like this. I think that's dangerous.
So when you get to the end of a movie that's successful, is your sense of accomplishment related to how the audience reacts or how the box office is, or is it really just you and the film and how you feel it stacks up?
Well, making a film is kind of like telling a joke. I mean, you would like to hear laughter. So if people don't like the movie, you feel bad. Mm-hmm. You feel hurt. I don't think there's a right or wrong.
But when they really like the movie, do you feel good?
Sure. Of course.
I'm trying to find your happy spot, I guess, is what I'm like.
No, I'm very dark. I think by definition, making a film is the process of failure. I actually think that's really what it is. It's poets said it better, a man's reach must exceed his grasp, lest what's a heaven for. I think you have to reach farther than you can attain. So you have to fall short of where you were trying. And if you aim high enough, it may turn out okay.
So have you ever felt like you achieved your grasp?
No.
Not in one of those movies?
I can't watch them. I've never once I can't make it better, I can't see it.
So if it comes on cable or satellite or whatever,
no, it's too painful. Much too painful. Because I can see all the things I did wrong.
So how did your relationship with Van Damme start?
I was approached to do this film called Time Cop. And I met with Van Damme, who said he had made a list, and I was like number one, and Ridley Scott was number two, and I went, yeah, right.
But you were on his list. It wasn't the other way around.
Yeah.
He brought you into a project he was already.
And we had lots of talks, and I said, you know, I want to make it different than what you've done. And I don't want to do the kind of fight action things the way you've done it, which is a lot of slow motion and a lot of that. It just wasn't, that's not me. It doesn't interest me, and it takes the savagery out of it, and it takes the, you know, a kick is a brutal thing, and when it's all slowed down, it's not. It's balletic, and I, you know, go to the ballet if you want to see ballet, if you want to see something balletic. And he agreed, and was wonderful. You know, he was just absolutely wonderful. He was trusting and threw himself into it, and was, it worked out.
Do you think he was looking for a change? I mean, it's such a, that was kind of a hip, hinge movie for him as a career.
I don't know what he was looking for, except he was certainly looking to make, I think he was reaching to try to make a good movie. And something slightly different than what he had done before. Otherwise, you know, because I said, if you don't put yourself in my hands, there's no point in me doing this, because I don't want to do that. I don't kind of work that way. And he was wonderful.
Is it fun to kind of take on a person who's not traditionally known for his acting, but for his kicking, and kind of make that work?
Well, you know, this guy was a friend of mine who I think is a really fine director, named Andy Davis. And Andy made the best film Steven Seagal ever made in his life, and he made the best film that Chuck Norris ever made. And I remember saying to my sons, I would love to make the best film this guy's ever done. That would be fun. And it worked out.
So did you feel at the end that you had done that? Or do you hate that as much as everything else?
It was considered his most successful film, and so I think I, in some respects, did it. Yeah.
So just easy to go and then go back to work with him and.
No, in this one I had the original script that was offered to me had Jean-Claude Van Damme playing the part that Tom Scott played, and I said, been there, done that, and I'll do it if he plays the bad guy, and I'll try to fashion a part, a character that is so flamboyant and so lunatic and so psychotic that he can make a real splash. And I had seen JCVD, the film he had done, and I realized he's funny. He's actually funny. And Jean-Claude is not somebody who does things halfway, so he embraced it. And he went all the way. And the reason for the film is, I think, to present and surprise people with a different persona than he's ever done.
And fantastic hair.
Yes. Yes.
He has a mane in this movie, practically.
Almost carrot red, too.
Yeah. It's wild. So does he, you adjusted the script to...
Totally.
Environmentalness, environmentalist thing?
Yes, totally. The guy... Two brothers wrote the script, and I told them what I wanted, and they were great. They came up with the idea of him being this vegan and all that stuff, and and I said, it's got to be somebody whose emotions have no arc. There's no curve. It's all 90 degrees. So he goes from being sweet and smiling to putting a knife in somebody's abdomen, and there's no transition, which to me is really what a psychotic is.
And Tom Scott and Orlando Jones also kind of play against type.
Which is why I wanted them so much. I always, you know, if I've done nothing, I think I've presented some actors in roles that they don't ordinarily do. Billy in like Running Scared is a perfect example. And I, you know, I think I'd made a film with Michael Douglas, and Orlando was in it, and he was wonderful. So I definitely wanted to work with him, and I've always been a fan of Tom Scott since I saw him in Tom Hanks's movie, That Thing You Do. And you know, he's a big guy, he's a good athlete. They threw themselves into these fights and rehearsed and rehearsed and rehearsed and practiced, and they were joys.
Speaking of which, you just actually perked my interest. Was directing O.J. fun? Was he a good actor, or was he an athlete?
What's the Dirty Harry's line? A man's got to know his limitations. you kind of know who you have, and you kind of know how unlimited or limited the palette they're going to present you with. And you work within those parameters to try to make the best out of them. I mean, I want everyone to look good. I want everybody to be good. That's what being a... I love actors. I'm in awe of actors. The forgetting the talent, the courage that it takes to be an actor. So to me, directing actors is creating a place where they feel brave and they feel comfortable. You start out with a blank computer screen, and you write a character, you create a character. It was blank before that. You write every word, you even describe them sometimes. So you think it's your character, except the second you cast it, it's not your character. It's the actor. And so I've said before, and I'll say it again, the saddest days you ever have shooting a movie are the days you stagger back to your hotel or your home having shot what you expected. You want to be surprised. So it's what they bring. It's what makes Sean Connery or Michael Douglas, you know, it's what they bring that makes it different than if you had somebody else, and that's what you exploit.
Does it matter what you expect? I mean, do you go in, obviously you have to know what their boundaries are in terms of their skill set. But you're, as we were saying, you've kind of taken a number of people and put them in places that
not
normally are.
When you are dealing with the Sean Connerys and the Michael Douglases and the Gene Hackmans and the Catherine Deneuves and the Harrison Fords, the people that I've made films with, they're great actors. You know, they can do anything.
Well, Harrison, it seemed like that movie was a stretch for him.
I don't think so.
It was like, back in that moment, it seemed like it was...
Except I thought he was a really exciting new guy. I thought he was just fabulous. Mm-hmm. You know, I loved him in Star Wars. I just loved him in Star Wars. Mm-hmm. So, turns out America did, you know.
Yeah. And somebody like Sean Connery, that was another one that was kind of like very quiet, relatively, for him. But fit, ultimately.
I made two films with Sean. I think he could do anything. I mean, I've seen him be wonderfully funny. I've seen him be romantic. I've seen him be mean. I've seen him be anything in the world. I mean, you look at The Hill. Did you ever see The Hill? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, that's the same guy who played James Bond. I think Connery, Hackman, those guys, Michael Douglas, they could do anything.
So there are other things on your set, what do you go home surprised about, that please you on a given day? Or is it really the performance, since you're behind the camera,
When you're actually on the set, you've already seen the wardrobe, when you've already seen the designs and those things. I don't know if this makes sense. Directing a film is kind of orchestrating a collective myopia. You want the production designer to think of nothing except the sets, and kind of be a little upset when people are walking in front of it. You want everybody to think of what they're doing, because they'll come up with things that you never, ever, ever, ever thought of. I remember when I was doing Capricorn One, there was a young actor named Bobby Walden. And I was in the middle of setting up a very complex thing around a pool table. Mm-hmm. And Bobby said to me, came up to me right in the middle of it, and he said, "What if I have a Band-Aid on my glasses?" I went, "Fine, you know, who cares?" 4 or 5 months later, I'm sitting in an editing room and I'm looking at him, and I'm looking at the Band-Aid and the glasses, and I'm going, "God damn, that was a good idea." And I never in a million years would have thought about it. That's what you want.
How big a part of your work is cutting? Do you find movies in the cutting room, or you kind of know?
No, I don't think you find a movie in a cutting room, except I think Because film editing is the one part of filmmaking that is not irrevocable. Mm-hmm. I want very strong-willed, opinionated editors. And I leave them to fashion the film. I'll argue and fight with them, except I'm so impatient with my own work that if left alone, I would cut a film down to 90 seconds and I'd have a pretty good teaser. I've actually been locked out of my own editing rooms by film editors. And one of them, I swear to God, one of them was in my house, in the back of my house, I swear to you. The editor was brilliant. My son was the editor on this film. He's dazzling, he's so talented. I could put the film together. It just wouldn't be nearly as good. So I think since you can, you have lots of choices and you can go, no, let's make that a little longer or take four frames out of that. You can do that with editing. You can't do that when you're shooting because whatever you shoot, that's it. I want people with talent to edit the film.
But it sounds like you're so tough on yourself that you would not be a good editor of your films.
Not of my film, yourself. No, I'd be a bad editor.
Do you think you'd be a good editor of other people's stuff?
Not as good as John Hyams, and not as good as Stuart Baird, and not as good as Michael Kahn. No, yeah. No way.
They do have a magic. It's like it's
They're
one
great.
Of the most understood forms, I think, in the film business.
Oh, I think it's an extraordinary profession. I do think it's extraordinary.
So does being a jazz drummer affect you as a filmmaker?
Yes.
Does that rhythm?
Yes, very much so. I have this theory that I've espoused to people that, you know, when you make a film and you cut it together, you temp it. You use a temp score. Mm-hmm. And you try to pick a temp score from a good film that's bears resemblance to what you're doing. And if the film is cut properly, when you play it against the temp score, it'll hit right on a whole bunch of cuts. I mean, and you start to laugh because it's right there. And my theory is that film music, and as a result, film, is based on a heartbeat. So suspenseful things are based on 60 to 70 beats a minute, and action things are based on 120 to 140 beats a minute, because that's the human heart, and that's my years as a drummer has made me money. Unfortunately, it's $1 or $2 at a time. Sitting in a dubbing stage or sitting in an editing room, I can say that's one frame out or two frames out, and we would bet. On the mixing stage, we'd bet whether it's one frame or two frames, and I tend to win those. However, whatever skill or talent I have earns me $1 at a time. That's about it.
For the swear jar.
Mm-hmm.
So is it still as exciting to shoot, to actually physically shoot the movie, to be the DP on a picture like this? I've noticed a number
it's
of
much
kind
more.
Of big moves and...
It's much more exciting because it's first place, this film was shot in a very short amount of time. I mean, it was a 27-day schedule. Most photographers will tell you that night exteriors and day interiors are kind of what separates men from boys or women from girls. And this is a film that was basically night exterior in the woods, mountains, and on water. One of the most difficult things you could ever do. So it was a huge challenge, an absolutely huge challenge. And I wanted to see if I could make a film of big scope, of complex and large action in this really short amount of time. You know, I think a director's job is to pour a quart of water into a pint bottle. And that's what I try to do.
And this is not exactly a CG heavy movie.
No, not at all.
That all, I assume, intentionally.
Yeah, you know, I've seen things written about me. Somebody wrote about me. I don't know if it was on IMDb or whatever it is. I'm known for using natural light, And my answer was, where the hell is natural light on a film stage?
Right.
And where's natural light in the woods at night? You know, I love where every single foot candle of light I've made. I love
it. Well, I read another thing where it said that you're known for being on stages and not wanting to have complete control of the space.
I love, it's like drawing, it's like painting. You know, it's so exciting. It's physically exciting.
And as you get older, is the physical demands of being a director and a DP getting harder, or is it just you're staying in shape and going with it?
I just don't sit down. It's simple as that. That's all. No, it's so. You have to be in shape to do it. You have to get yourself in shape to do it. You have to. It's. I ran in school. And I never ran the 800, except the 800 is the worst race there is, because it's a distance race and it's a sprint at the same time. So people who run the 800 are, to me, insane and also dazzling. And that's kind of like a film. It's a bit of a marathon, and you fight sleep deprivation, and then you fight sometimes the elements, especially if it's a lot of exteriors. And nights, this film is mostly night. But however, it's also a sprint at the same time, because you're trying to put that quart of water into that pint bottle. Doesn't get, you know, I think if I was one of those people, I mean, Steven Spielberg doesn't get tired of making movies, and look at what he's done. So, God, why should I, you know, I haven't done that yet.
But he does have Janusz to carry some of the.
Yeah, but what I'm saying, though, however, is that he's made great, great stuff, and he hasn't said, "Okay, I've done it. I'm done."
Yeah.
He loves the process. I love the process.
And is obviously, as you just said, you don't look at your films, but no. Do you look back at all, or are you a person?
I cannot look at a film when I can no longer make it better.
Right. But do you reflect on your career, on your work, on what you've done?
No, just wish I was better.
So you just get up every morning and it's the next thing in front of you and full steam ahead.
I'm married to an extraordinary woman, and there are times where we sit at breakfast and I look at her and I stare at her and I kind of try to look through the pupil of her eye into the cranial cavity, and she goes, "What?" I go, "What's it like?" She goes, "What's what like?" I said, "Being well adjusted. What's that like?" I don't know.
So being a director is, by definition, being well-adjusted?
I don't know. I just know me.
And you're driven to go.
Yeah, I'm terribly driven and obsessive. And I mean, I've many times when I'm shooting and something requires doing it over and over again because it's technically ambitious or whatever it is, or the crane's not doing what it's supposed to do, and I've had so many times people come to me and say, "God, you're really patient." And I go, "I'm not patient, I'm relentless. There's a big difference. I'm impatient, except I'm so obsessed that I just want to do it."
And is there anything big picture that you're going, "I need to still get this done, this is the thing I haven't done and I really want to do it," or is it just the next project that inspires you to want to get out there and do it?
You just get crushes, you know? It's just whatever story you get a crush on. And whatever comes into my empty head, sometimes, you know, you sit and write it.
So you don't desperately need to make a musical or
I've
a
always
Western
wanted,
horses?
I always wanted to make a musical because I grew up in the theater and I really wanted to make a musical, and more than any film in the world, I wanted to make Les Mis. That's the film I wanted to make. And that's been done and done well, so. There's no type of film I want to make. I just want to make a good film.
And do you still love film in general? Do you watch everything?
God, yes. Oh, God, yes. I just don't think there's a more extraordinary medium, although I'm pretty obsessive about cable television. I mean, I think cable television has become what films were in the 70s when they refer to those kind of ambitious and not down the middle you know, with the exceptions of the Spike Jonzes and the David Russells, who I think are nothing short of brilliant, studios tend to, you know, want to make big, thick, fat, 80-mile-an-hour pitches down the middle of the plate. Preferably if they have a Roman numeral after them, so it's a... So, with some glaring exceptions, that's the fare of movie studios, whereas cable television is doing House of Cards, and cable television is doing those True Detective, and they're doing those things. And so I love to watch that, too.
So if they came to you and said, do Avengers 3, probably not your thing.
No, I don't want to do... I'm not interested in doing a sequel, and I'm not interested in doing something based on a graphic novel, and it's for other people to do. It's just not my taste. I mean, there are films around that I would have loved to do. Thank God I didn't do them, because you can't do Girl with the Dragon Tattoo better than Fincher did it. You just can't. But I would have, you know, that's the kind of movie that would have fascinated me.
Right. So something from source material, but not something that's been drawn out before with all those expectations. And
if David Russell had given me the script of Silver Linings Playbook, I doubt if I could have made half of as good a movie as he made. I mean, you know, you sit there and you go, what possessed him to cast that actress? I mean, what? Who is maybe the most exciting new actress there is? How did he come up with that? You know, it's. I admire those people.
It's still a remarkable thing in that movie that she was playing, theoretically playing 33, 34, or whatever, and she was 20 years old, 22 years old.
And, the performance is astonishing. Yeah. I mean, you know, she's amazing. I don't know on what he based his choice, except it's remarkable.
So the excitement for you, you'd love to get Jennifer Lawrence in front of you where your camera's just...
Oh, who wouldn't? I mean, you know, it's and that's a hell of a risk.
Just a fat pitch down the middle.
Yeah. Well, I know. I mean, a great actress is a great actress. They're rare, and when you get a chance to work with them, you leap. She's a great actress. I've had the privilege of working with a couple of extraordinary actresses. You know, it's just I love actors. I don't know what to say. I love them.
Even Schwarzenegger.
Yeah, sure, sure.
He was magic. He really did have an on-screen.
Absolute. You know, when you work with there's a reason why somebody becomes a movie star, and I don't know what the reason is. Mm-hmm. There's a famous line by William Wyler, who had Betty Davis do kind of 40, 70 takes or something, and she had never done more than something like 6 or something, and she finally screamed at him, just tell me what you want. And he said, I don't know, except I'll know it when I see it. Mm-hmm. So that's what a movie star is. And when you have a movie star, or somebody with the qualities of a movie star, and you're in the cutting room, and a scene's not totally working the way you want it to work, you go, let's cut to him, or let's cut to her, mm-hmm. because there's something going on in your face. And it's just interesting.
And when you're shooting a movie, did you know it when you see it, or did you already know it before you... Did you know what you were going for before you walked in the door, and know whether you got it?
Well, I certainly had a plan. I certainly had a very firm idea of what I wanted it to be. And once you've cast it, you can picture what they're going to do. Mm-hmm. You have to leave yourself open to accident, though. You just have to. That's what making a film is. It's a series of controlled accidents. As a director, you try to keep the accidents in context, except you want accidents.
And the best accidents are the ones you're happiest.
Oh, sure.
That's the thing you most love.
If the film is only as good as I am, it's not going to be as good as I want it to be. I was talking with Jim Cameron once, and who's one of the smartest people I've ever had the pleasure of being around in my life. And I said something to Jim, and he said, why do you want so-and-so? And I said, my plan is to be the dumbest person on my set. if I'm the smartest person on my set, we're screwed. So I like to surround myself with smart people and strong-willed people. Mm-hmm.